I'm Mark Kelly, and I'm the smarter and better looking astronaut.
Hey, Mark, I'm standing right here. Unlike when I was in space for a year, I can actually hear what you're saying.
You know, folks, that was the best year of my life.
Mine too, so why do you get to talk first anyway?
Well, isn't it obvious? I'm 6 minutes older than you are.
So that's the only 6 minutes he was the smarter and better looking brother.
I think I should get to talk first because I'm the more experienced astronaut. I've flown in space for 500 days versus his 50 days or minutes, whatever that was. It was actually 54 days, but if we're talking about experience, you know, I was the pilot of the space shuttle twice and the commander twice, and you only did that once. But go ahead anyway.
You know the great thing about being in space for an entire year is you can't hear your twin brother whining. Well, my name is Scott Kelly. It's great to be here. Actually, after being in space for a year, it's great to be anywhere with gravity. And to those of you in the audience that do not appear to be space aliens, we'd like to say good morning or good afternoon. And to the rest of you, we come in peace.
So it was in, I think it was September 1962, that our president, John F. Kennedy, said, "We choose to go to the moon and do those other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard." And we think the greatest gift that we can give to all of our children and grandchildren are to continue to do those hard things.
So people often ask my brother and I, what's the best part about flying in space and having the privilege of flying in space? Because we do think this is a privilege. Is it the launch? Is it floating around in zero gravity? Is it looking out at the Earth, which is incredibly beautiful? Is it the landing? And what's the best part about this? And for my brother Mark and I, best part about flying in space is that it's really, really hard. It's a really hard thing to do. It's really challenging. And that's what makes it so great. And that's what we want to talk to all of you about today, is about doing hard things and how we were able to do that in our career. And for us, it involved a few other things. It was about having a goal and a plan. It was about taking risks and not being scared to fail. It was about focusing on the things that we could control and ignoring what we couldn't. It was about testing the status quo, and it was about working as a team. Because for Mark and I, when we were able to put all these different things together, what we realized is the sky is not the limit.
So like many of you, we came from a very rather ordinary background. We grew up in New Jersey, about 20 miles outside of New York City. Our dad was a stereotypical, tough New Jersey Irish detective. He used to come home at least once a year with a cast on his right arm. Now he would tell Scott and I that he broke his hand fighting crime, bar fight, what we learned later. And our mom was a secretary and a waitress pretty much at the same time. And this was a time in our lives that we did not do the best in school, and we didn't have great direction, really. And for some reason, around that time, our mother decided she was going to become a cop like our dad. And this is New Jersey in the 1970s. And for a woman to become a police officer was a really hard thing to do. And our mom had to pass this test. And part of this test was a physical fitness test that included climbing over a 7-foot-2-inch wall. Now, our mother was all about 4 feet, 13 inches. She had to climb over this wall, and to help our mother out, our dad built a replica of this thing in our backyard. And he didn't tell our mother that he made it an inch higher at 7'3". And we'd watch our mom go out there after dinner every night. Initially, she couldn't even reach the top of this thing. And when she could, she would usually just fall off into the dirt. But after months and months of practicing, when she finally took this test, instead of getting over the required 9 seconds, she got over 4.5, which was much faster than almost all of the men, and she became one of the first female police officers in that part of New Jersey. Well, this was the first time in our lives that we saw the power of having a goal and a plan and what it meant to work really, really hard.
So Mark and I grew up in the 1960s and 70s during the height of the Apollo space program and the TV show I Dream of Jeannie. And like Mark said, we weren't particularly good students. You know, for me, really for a long time, for him at first. So being an astronaut was not even something that was a possibility for us. It didn't really seem a possibility when we were younger. But I do remember the first time I said I I wanted to be an astronaut, and it was in the first grade, and I was in the boys' bathroom, standing next to one of my classmates in front of the urinal, doing what first grade boys do in there. They're both peeing on the floor. I know what you're thinking, but I was not the other kid. And this kid, he turns to me and he says, Scott, what do you want to do when you grow up? And I said, I don't know, play baseball for the Mets. And he says, I want to be an astronaut. And I thought to myself, you know, despite this not really being a possibility, I thought how cool that sounded and how it was such a great goal. And I said to him, I said, I want to be an astronaut too. He turns to me and he says, you can't be an astronaut because I'm going to be an astronaut. I actually wish I could find this kid today, not to humiliate him or anything. I'd just be curious what he's up to. You know, one of the secrets of success that we found is having goals. And even at a young age, I had a pretty ambitious goal. I decided I was going to become the first person to walk on the planet Mars. I really believed if I worked hard enough and maybe got lucky along the way, I'd make it to Mars. Well, I left NASA several years ago without ever making it to Mars, but I did get kind of close. I mean, I made it into space four times. Now, if any of you think that's impressive, getting into space four times, just think of how impressed the aliens were. When I told them that I had visited the planet Earth five different times, they were really impressed. But to get there, I had to have a plan. My plan was to become a naval aviator, then a Navy test pilot, then an astronaut. And when I graduated from college in 1986, I headed off to Navy flight school in Pensacola, Florida. Does anybody in here remember what movie came out in 1986?
Top Gun.
Well, I'm kind of embarrassed to tell you this. A little embarrassed, but I'm going to tell you anyway. Literally, as I drove through the gate of the Naval Air Station, I had that cheesy music from the movie playing on the tape deck. I think it was the Danger Zone song. And then I get there and I start flying for the Navy, and I very, very quickly find out that I am not Maverick. I am not a particularly good pilot. I really struggled for a long period of time. You know what the Navy does to you after a year in flight school? They send you to land on a ship for the first time. When the Navy sends you to land on an aircraft carrier for the very first time, there is not anybody that is crazy enough to go with you. So you go all by yourself, empty back seat. I remember flying out to the USS Forrestal. I remember some of it. You get overhead the ship, it's a little tiny landing area you gotta land on. And initially I'm gonna do what's called a touch and go landing, where you just touch the deck and take off. I did that twice. Third time around, I put the landing gear and flaps back down, but I also put the tail hook down. And that hook's supposed to catch one of the wires strung across the back of the ship. Well, it did. I completely missed the wires. I wind up in the air again, come around a fourth time. And when you land aboard the ship and the hook catches one of the arresting wires, it's like getting in a crash in your car. I mean, really, it's like crashing your car. You raise the hook, you go to this catapult, you get shot off 0 to 150 miles an hour in a couple seconds. I did that four more times. Entire experience was just a blur. Barely remember any of it. And then later that evening, I go back to the Naval Air Station, and I'm getting debriefed by the instructor pilot that was watching from the back of the ship. And you know what the first thing he says to me is? He says, are you sure this career is for you? You did not do well. And I'd be the first to admit how poorly I did. In fact, I think Tom Cruise would have been better at that than me. And I don't mean the character from the movie, I mean the actor. Tom Cruise probably would have been better at landing on the ship than I was. But you know what? I didn't give up. And the guys that did really well that day did not go on to become test pilots or astronauts. I know this because I often see them in the front on Southwest Airlines. But I really believe this. This is really important for the kids down here. There's a couple kids in here. That how good you are at the beginning of anything you try, how good you are at the beginning, it's not a good indicator of how good you can become. You know, I'm a prime example of somebody who was able to overcome a lack of aptitude for something with just three things: practice, persistence, and just not giving up. It's actually the only thing that ever really worked for me. So despite my efforts, I managed to graduate in the bottom half of my high school class. And I went on to college because that's what was expected of us at that time. But I actually went to the wrong school. And I don't mean like I went to this school over here thinking that, you know, this other school was a better fit. I actually applied to the school and showed up thinking I was going to this other college. This is actually true. And actually, I get there, and after a few weeks, I'm like, hey, when's the first football game? And they're like, we don't have a football team. That's that other school in Maryland, College Park. And I'm basically going through the same experience I had in high school. I couldn't pay attention. I didn't know how to study. I wasn't doing well on the exams. Pretty soon, I wasn't even going to class much. And one day, I'm walking across the college campus, and I go into the school bookstore to buy gum or potato chips or something, not a book. I don't think I'd ever bought a book up until this point in my life. I go inside and I see this book on the shelf. It's got this red, white, and blue cover. It's got this title that showed like motion in kind of a very positive direction. It really just made me pick it up, and I started paging through the pages, and I bought the book and took it back to my dorm room and laid there on my unmade dorm room bed for the next few days and read the stories in this book. It was about the fighter pilots that became the original Mercury, Gemini, and Apollo astronauts. And the book was The Right Stuff by Tom Wolfe. And I recognized traits in these characters and these real people that I felt like I had myself, despite being this 18-year-old kid that's never been able to do his homework or study or do anything. And this book was the spark. It made me decide right then and there that I was gonna try to be like these guys. I wasn't sure how I was gonna do it, but I was gonna handle it like my mother did, like my mother taught us about having a goal and a plan. I know what you're thinking, you know, 18-year-old kid deciding he's gonna be an astronaut. That's really a giant leap. But what it was really a bunch of very, very small, manageable steps to get there.
Yeah, I think for all of us, life is a set of challenges, right? Whether they're personal or professional. And other than landing on the ship, the aircraft carrier, one of my other big professional challenges happened in the summer of 1990 when Saddam Hussein invaded Kuwait. I was a pilot of an airplane called an A-6 Intruder, which is a two-person, all-weather ground attack airplane. I was stationed in Japan aboard the aircraft carrier, the USS Midway. And on this airplane, I was the pilot, and I had another guy, he was the bombardier navigator. And my bombardier navigator was a guy named Paul Fujimura. And Paul was a graduate of the University of California at Berkeley. I think he's perhaps the only person from Berkeley ever to go in the military. But he was a good guy, he was really good at his job, and we head to the Persian Gulf. And on January 17th of 1991, it was time for us to fly our first combat mission. So we head up to the flight deck early, our airplane's loaded with 8 1,000-pound bombs. We get in the cockpit, we turn everything on, taxi to the catapult, we get shot off the front of the ship, and we're heading towards a place called Shaiba Airfield, which is in the city of Basra in southern Iraq, to drop bombs on this maintenance hangar. And as soon as we get over land, we can see anti-aircraft artillery coming up at our airplane. And at night, you can see the tracers. And when the Iraqis on the ground would move these guns back and forth, it would look like a couple snakes coming up through the sky at you. Now, Winston Churchill said about his personal experience in combat, he said, there's nothing more exciting than being shot at and missed. Speaking from experience, the miss part is really important. And to get to our target, we had to go through this area in southern Iraq that had a huge air defense system. So we had to go through these missile envelopes to get to Shaiba Airfield. And I kept looking over my left-hand shoulder where these missile batteries were. But I gotta tell you, the worst feeling I've ever had in my life up to that point is seeing that missile come up that airplane, seeing bright dot, just getting bigger, not moving forward or aft in the canopy. So if it stays in the same position relative to you, it just grows bigger. You know what that means? It's just coming right at you. And I immediately say to my bombardier navigator, Paul, I say, I think we have a missile coming at us. Now his job is to find this hangar on our radar and infrared sensor. He's got his hand on this joystick. And his only response to me is, he says, Roger, I'm tracking the target. A little while later, I say, Paul, did you hear me? We've got a missile coming at us. Same thing, Roger, I'm tracking the target. So he's doing what we call in the Navy compartmentalization, which is focusing on the thing that you can control, finding the target. He can control that. This missile, that's my problem. You know, I know in your industry and in your careers, there is so many distractions out there with stuff that you have no control over, whether it's regulation in Washington, D.C., or the economy. And it's so hard to, it's so easy to be distracted, but it's so important to compartmentalize and focus on the things you can control. A little while later, this missile's about to hit us. I had full power, I roll the airplane upside down, I put the stick in my lap. We go down, missile goes over the top, explodes, big flash, airplane shakes, get the airplane turned upright again. And both engines are running, all four hydraulic systems still have pressure, so it doesn't seem like we have any holes in the airplane. So I get headed back towards the target. You know what's worse than seeing the first missile? Seeing the second one. Not going as I planned. We go through the same process again, this time with the missile not blowing up. And I gotta, I gotta stress how important it is, you know, when things are going wrong and things are getting very dynamic, how easy it is to be distracted, but how important it is to compartmentalize and focus on the things that we all can control.
So with my newfound spark that I got from the book, The Right Stuff, I changed schools, changed majors, got into a commissioning program in the U.S. Navy, graduated from college, and like my brother, I went off to flight school and became a naval aviator. But unlike him, I actually wound up flying the F-14 Tomcat, the airplane he wanted to fly. Oh, come on. You know what they say about fighter pilots and attack pilots in the Navy? It's that fighter pilots make movies and attack pilots make history. So the first time I took the F-14 Tomcat to the aircraft carrier, I can remember like it was yesterday and seeing the ship, which seemed like it was in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean, just kind of floating there like a postage stamp. And the first time I tried to do a arrested landing, I fly overhead, put my landing gear, my flaps, the hook down. And on my first attempt, I landed so low that the hook of the airplane actually hit what's called the round down, which is actually sort of like the stern of the ship, the part that goes down towards the water. And I rolled into the first wire and I stopped. You know, he's not being completely clear about this. You know, what he's describing is actually called crashing. It's not crashing. It's not crashing. And I raise the hook and I taxi forward. I think I'm going to the catapult to try my second landing, and they pull me aside and chain the airplane down and pull me out. Basically say the same thing as they said to my brother. Are you sure this career is for you? You almost crashed on your first attempt during the daytime, and the nighttime is the hard part. Daytime is, you know, everyone qualifies during the day, and the people that disqualify generally do it at night. And I wasn't even going to get a chance to try it at night. They just sent me back home to the beach. And over the course of the next few days, took me aside, and they said, okay, you know, here are your options. You can go fly something else, some other airplane, or you can give this another try. And if you know, give this another try and fail, you're probably not going to get to fly anything. And I had not done this at night, and the first time I would have to go to the ship at night was going to be my only chance to qualify. You know, I thought to myself, you know, I didn't know, you know, if I went to fly some heavy airplane, maybe I wasn't even going to be able to qualify doing that. And I thought to myself, you know, if I'm going to fail at something, might as well fail at something I think is really, really hard. Something that I think, you know, might be beyond my capabilities, rather than failing at something that's easier. So the Navy hooked me up with this radar intercept officer, like the goose in Top Gun, the guy that sits in the back. We practiced, and he recognized I could fly the airplane okay. I could control altitude, airspeed, heading course, all the things you need to do to successfully land the airplane on the ship. But I was just too comfortable when everything was perfect, too comfortable when everything was just right. And I wasn't making very, very small, constant corrections all the time. And because I wasn't doing that, things were going to get worse. I was too comfortable with the status quo, too comfortable with how things are. And this lesson for me was a lesson that enabled me to go successfully qualify on the ship, and whether I was flying airplanes or being a test pilot or flying a space shuttle or even the space station, or working in programs, working in things that are very, very challenging. You know, from this lesson I learned, if you're not making very, very small corrections all the time, things definitely aren't going to get better, and they're probably going to get worse.
So in 1996, through what I imagine was a NASA clerical error, both of us became astronauts.
And in 2001, it was time for me to fly my first space shuttle flight.
Now, the space shuttle, people often think of the space shuttle as that white-looking thing that looks like an airplane. We actually call that the orbiter. With the external tank and two solid rocket boosters, that's a space shuttle altogether. And when it sits on the launch pad and it's fully fueled, it weighs almost 4 million pounds. Fully fueled. And when you go off to fly that thing on the real day, the launch pad is pretty much abandoned because this thing is pretty much a bomb sitting on a hill. And you climb into the vehicle about 3 hours before liftoff, you get strapped in, you're laying on your backs, the hatch is closed, you gotta start turning on all the systems of the space shuttle, APUs, hydraulic, electrical system, Ohm's engines, RCS engines, main engines have to be in the right configuration. There's 2,000 switches and circuit breakers that all have to be in the right place. You're working through this big checklist. There's a countdown clock heading towards zero. That clock stops a couple times to let you catch up if you've gotten behind.
It's also, when it stops, it's also the time you think to yourself, man, this is a really stupid thing I'm doing. You're flying space. But you can't get out because they close that hatch on you. Then eventually that clock gets to 6 seconds and the three main engines start, but you don't go anywhere because you are bolted down to the launch pad with 8 giant bolts about this big. Just bolted down, nothing holding you at the top. Then that clock goes 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. When it hits zero, those bolts explode. The two solid rocket boosters ignite, and it is literally like the hand of God came down and grabbed you and ripped you off the planet. You know, on TV, it looks like you're going up really smoothly. Doesn't feel anything like that. Incredible amount of vibration, and what it feels like is, imagine being on a runaway train going down the railroad tracks at 1,000 miles an hour, and you just keep accelerating. We go from zero to 17,500 miles an hour in just 8.5 minutes. 2 minutes into the flight, those white solid rocket boosters, they come off, parachute into the ocean. NASA sends a ship out there, picks them up, sends them back to the factory in Idaho to refurbish them. We reuse them.
They're only slightly more expensive to reuse.
A little while later, we're going 25 times the speed of sound. Main engine shut down. Big orange tank comes off, flies halfway around the planet, hits the atmosphere over the Pacific Ocean, and explodes. Pieces go into the ocean. And then we're in orbit around this incredible planet. It's such an amazing thing to see, this big, round, blue ball just floating there in the blackness of space. No strings attached. We're going around it every 90 minutes. It's a sunrise or sunset every 45 minutes. And the first time I saw this, I was struck just by the fact that, you know, there's 7.5 billion of us living on this planet. And this thing that we live on is literally an island in our solar system. And we've got no place else to go.
Not sure why my brother gets to tell this story, because I flew the space shuttle about 3 years before he did. Very similar. I mean, what he said was accurate. I can just remember the first time in the space shuttle, you know, trying not to, you know, push a button at the wrong time or throw a switch up at the wrong time and blow the thing up. That it was just what Mark said, compartmentalization, focusing on the things you can control and ignoring what you can't. So I didn't look outside one time, the whole 8.5 minutes to orbit. About 20 minutes after we get into space, I just happen to look outside and I see something on the horizon that I didn't recognize. I said to the commander of the space shuttle, I said, what the hell is that? And he said, that's the sunrise. And as the sun came up, I saw how brilliantly blue our planet Earth was. It's almost like someone took the most brilliant blue paint and just painted it on a mirror right in front of my eyes. And, you know, at that very moment, I knew I would never see anything as beautiful as our planet Earth ever again. This mission was a Hubble telescope repair mission, an emergency mission to the Hubble. It was spinning out of control, and a couple days later we grabbed it. It's about the size of a school bus, and we put it in the payload bay. We did 3 spacewalks to fix it. This was in December of 1999. We had to deploy it on Christmas Day, and we had to come home early because of Y2K. NASA was worried the space shuttle computers were going to divide by zero, and we were going to end up going through some wormhole and wind up on the other side of the universe.
movie landed right before Christmas. And ever since then, I've had this kind of, you know, relationship with Hubble and a, you know, fascination for what this telescope has shown us about our place in the universe. A decade or so ago now, NASA pointed the telescope at this black spark, this spot in the sky where they thought there was nothing, like a width of a dime at the back of this, whatever this thing is called, this room. And they left it there for 2 weeks. And when they exposed the image, they saw over 3,000 galaxies in this tiny, tiny speck of the sky, much like our Milky Way galaxy, which has billions of stars. A few years later, they pointed the telescope in the exact opposite direction and saw the same exact thing, thousands of galaxies, much like our Milky Way galaxy. And from these images, and because we know our universe is spread out evenly all around the sky, scientists were able to figure out and calculate that there are more stars in the universe than grains of sand on every beach and desert on planet Earth. A few months ago, they actually realized they were wrong. They were off by a factor of 10. It's actually 10 times as many stars as all the sand on Earth. And that is just something that is almost incomprehensible to just kind of put your head around. You know, because of these kind of numbers and, you know, the fact that I've spent a lot of time in space, people often ask me, hey, have you seen anything funny out there? Anything you can't explain, doesn't make sense? You know what I'm getting at, right? The alien question. So when I was in the Navy, I visited Area 51. There, unfortunately, I can't tell you that there were no aliens there. It's because we moved them all to Area 52. So please don't share that with anyone. I don't want the Men in Black showing up tomorrow.
But my wife, Gabby Giffords, entered Congress for the first time in 2007. I thought we had the risky jobs, cloning combat, cloning space on the space shuttle. And as it would turn out, my wife, Gabby, is the one who nearly lose her life serving her country. The day she was injured, there was no countdown clock. What I mean by this, normally like for big events in my life, like a combat mission or a space flight, there's a clock, it starts on time. I pretty much know the trajectory we're gonna be on and the kind of decisions that are gonna have to be made. This is a Saturday morning. I was at home in Houston, Texas, and I was talking to my eldest daughter about something, and my cell phone rings. And I knew Gabby had gone to this Congress on Your Corner event where she would meet with her constituents and just stand there in this grocery store parking lot and talk to them all day. And the woman on the other end of the cell phone was my wife's chief of staff. She says, Mark, I don't know how to tell you this, but Gabby's been shot. She didn't have a lot of information. We hung up from that call. I told my daughter, wake your sister up. A little while later, I thought, did I just imagine this phone call? So I literally walked up to my cell phone, I picked it up, and I saw I had that incoming call. And then I called Gabby's chief of staff back, and I said, tell me that again? And that's when she gave me the really, really devastating news. My wife had been shot in the head. And at that moment, I realized that this was certainly going to be our biggest challenge. Well, I had to get to Tucson in a hurry from Houston, Texas. I had a good friend with a corporate airplane, my mom and my kids. We take off west for that two-hour flight. And I got to admit, I think one of the dumber things I've done in my life is watch this day unfold on the TV, on the airplane, without the ability to talk to anybody. But we get about halfway to Tucson, and that's when CNN, MSNBC, and Fox News all pronounce my wife dead. We sat there for about 30 minutes looking at a picture of that graphic that said Gabrielle Giffords, 1970 to 2011. A little while later, they come back, and they say, well, no, they made a mistake. She's actually in surgery. Well, you know what? You know, the media shouldn't be pronouncing people dead, right? They should leave that up to doctors to do. And I can tell you this, my wife, Gabby, was not gonna get taken out by cable news.
So on this day, January 8, 2011, I was on the space station. I was halfway through what I used to call a long duration flight, which was 6 months long. I was working on the toilet. It was a Saturday. For some reason, the toilet always breaks on the weekends, and we had time to fix it. And I was like elbow deep in the toilet, just like you would imagine.
You know, sometimes astronauts have to do like crappy jobs too.
So I'm fixing the toilet, and the control center comes up, and they say, we're privatizing the space to ground channel. And I never heard that before. And that's when they're going to tell you something and they don't want the public to hear that might be listening on the internet or NASA TV. And they, chief of the astronaut office comes up and she says, you know, I don't know how to tell you this, so I'm just going to tell you your sister-in-law, Gabby, was shot and a bunch of people killed, others injured. You know, this was one of those moments on the space station. I immediately get on the phone to my brother, but I recognize that, you know, there's nothing that happens on Earth that could, you know, allow me to come home when you're in space like that on this type of mission. So, you know, this is definitely one of those moments where, you know, I absolutely had to focus on the things I could control, which was, you know, being the commander of the space station and you know, leading my crew and, you know, operating the systems and ignoring what I couldn't, which was, you know, all this bad stuff that was going on down on Earth.
You know, around this time in 2011, NASA was first starting to think about sending somebody into space for a year. Now, we've sent people up into space for about 6 months at a time, but never for that long. Well, the reason we need to send somebody into space for these longer periods of time, you know, up to a year, is because someday, maybe not too far in the future, we want to send the first humans to Mars. And to get to Mars and come back and do that entire mission, it's going to take a really long time. It takes 6 months to get there, 6 months to get back, and if you want to stay for more than a week, you got to stay almost a year. So we're talking about space missions of about 2.5 years. We don't have a lot of data, particularly about the human body. You know, the rocket science stuff, you know, we kind of got that figured out, what it would take to send people to Mars. The political science is kind of complicated, but the human physiology is a really difficult thing to do if we want to send people into space for these 2.5 year missions. So eventually they figured out that they need to send somebody into space for a year, and it ultimately wound up being Scott.
And one of my Russian colleagues, a guy named Misha Kornienko, I now refer to him as my brother from another Russian mother, and him and the Soyuz commander and I, for the second time in my life, in March of 2015, I find myself in this place called Baikonur, Central Asia, where we launch on the Soyuz, and now that the space shuttle is retired, that's our only way to get people into space, at least for the time being. And the Soyuz is somewhat similar to the space shuttle in that, you know, it launches into space and it carries people. That's kind of where all the similarities stop. But you find yourself in the Russian version of the Astro van, and you're heading up to the launch pad, and the rocket's fully fueled, much smaller, the capsule's much smaller, it's you know, it's about as small as it can be, and you can still fit three people in there. You sit in there elbow to elbow, your knees up to your chin. And we're walking up to the launch pad. But that's where the similarities kind of stop. And unlike the space shuttle, where the launch pad is completely abandoned because this thing could blow up, Russians have a different philosophy about things. And, you know, one philosophy is, if your friends are going on a long trip, you're going to be there to say goodbye. So we get up to the launch pad, fully fueled rocket, vapor coming off of it, covering the super cool vapor coming off of it, covering the launch pad. There's like 100 people up there. And you're just trying to get through them to get to the launch pad or get to the rocket. And some of these people are smoking cigarettes. You're like, is that guy really smoking? But you can't get away, you know, you're committed. You get through the crowd, you go up on this little tiny elevator that you can barely fit three people in. You get in, you get strapped in. It's hot inside, your visor is fogging over, it's dark, it's loud. There's no countdown clock. They didn't think to put a countdown clock in the Soyuz. This is gonna be the rocket that launched nuclear weapons at us during the Cold War. There's no countdown clock. Time is passing, and after a while you're like, hey, what time are we leaving? Is that 10:10, right? Is that Moscow time or Baikonur time? Pretty soon some guy comes up on the radio, all he says is ignition. You hear these turbo pumps start, the rocket motors light. You do kind of lift off slowly because it doesn't have the solid rocket motors. But still, after 9 minutes, you're in space going around the Earth at 25 times the speed of sound. Within 6 hours, we're docking to the International Space Station. We do some leak checks. A few hours later, me and my colleague Misha, we float through the hatch together. And I, you know, the sights and the sounds of the space station, I just feel like I had never left. I was there 4 years ago. I felt like I had never left. And immediately think to myself, you know, I got a year in front of me. This is a really stupid thing to be doing, spending the whole year in space. But you can't come back. Then you're wondering what the space station is like. It's a million pounds, weighs a million pounds if it was on Earth. To put that in perspective, you have about 250 million pounds of hardware out here at your show. So it's, you know, 1/250th of what you have out here. It's about the size of a football field, the internal volume of a 5-bedroom house. We have everything, you know, inside we need to keep ourselves alive. We have food, we have spare parts. You know, some of this stuff you don't even know what it is or how long it's been there. We have some water. We have systems that keep us alive, produce oxygen, scrub carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. We take our urine on the space station and we turn it into water, which we drink, which we then turn into urine again, drink it again after we turn it into water. So I drank my pee for an entire year.
He also drank everybody else's pee.
It's all mixed together. But the purpose of the space station is to do science. And over the course of the year I was there, we did 400 different type of scientific experiments. And some of those are focused on improving life right here on Earth. Material science, biology, chemistry, physics, basic science, pharmaceuticals to develop drugs and treatments for things that happen to us in space that are very similar to what happens to us as we age. And then there's the science that's exploration based. How do we get out of low Earth orbit today, someday? How do we go to Mars or other places? And that's the human research that Mark was talking about, understanding why we lose 1% of our bone mass every month in space and we don't do anything about it. You know, understanding and controlling the loss of muscle mass, the effects on our vision, and the genetic effects we might have from all the radiation we get in space. I got the equivalent of 20 chest x-rays every day for my 520 days I've spent in space. So understanding those effects and being able to prevent them so we someday can go to Mars is what we're doing on the space station.
And since Scott and I are identical twins, NASA took this opportunity to do a lot of science on both of us. He was the lab rat in space, and I was the lab rat on Earth. And there were a bunch of different studies. One of them that got a lot of attention had to do with these things called our telomeres, which is the stuff on your DNA. And the length of your telomeres is indicative of how old you really are. And the theory is that because of the radiation, Scott's telomeres would shorten compared to mine. So if, like 10 years from now, I look like I'm 60 years old, and he looks like he's 80, you'll know what happened.
Mark got Botox in it, he's probably what happened. So, you know, living in space is really hard. When you wake up and you're at work, when you go to sleep and you're at work, it's definitely a privilege, but it's really a challenge. You can't go outside, no fresh air, no wind, no sun, no rain. You always have to be ready for an emergency. During the course of the year I was there, we had a bunch of fire alarms. Mostly false alarms. We did have one fire in one of the science experiments. This risk of this super high concentrated ammonia that cools the outside of the space station getting inside. There's also risk of orbital debris. There's a lot of debris up there. There's one day in the summer where the ground comes up and they say we're privatizing the space to ground channel. And I immediately thought back to Gabby and what happened to her and maybe something, you know, bad had happened on the Earth. But pretty soon I hear about this, you know, Russian satellite coming at us at 17,500 miles an hour in the exact opposite direction, 35,000 miles an hour closure. We didn't see it in time. We can't move the space station out of the way. It's going to get within a mile. We're not sure, you know, how close, but we have to, you know, protect for possible impact. So I'm up there with two Russians. The U.S. Control Center has me close or check all 18 hatches on the U.S. side of the space station. And the space station's broken up into a U.S. part and a Russian part. And I know what the Russians' philosophy on this, but you know, I float down there and seeing it in person was something I will never forget. My two colleagues, Gennady and Misha, you know, they're not doing anything to prepare for this. They're having lunch.
You know, the way they think about stuff like this, the Russian attitude is there's two really probable outcomes. The thing misses them entirely, or they get hit and everything gets vaporized in a second. But the probability of anything else happening in between is so low that they don't even care to address it.
So they're like, would you like some lunch? And I'm like, you know, it was lunchtime, sure. And so we have lunch, and then eventually, you know, we're getting to the closest point of approach. We go to the Soyuz just in case, you know, we get hit and that, you know, we could use it as a lifeboat, and we're inside, and it's now cold, and it's dark, it's loud. Gennady in the center seat, he says, it will really suck if this satellite hits us. And Misha says, Dom, it will suck. And I notice Misha looking outside, and I say, you know, Misha, it's dark, and this thing's going 35,000 miles an hour. You're not going to see anything. Then I notice myself looking outside. And as the time passes, and we start getting to the closest point of approach, we're all like grimacing and holding our breath and tensing up as if this is going to somehow help. Eventually, the clock gets to zero. 30 seconds later, the control center says, the danger has passed. You guys can go back to work now. So, you know, my colleagues go back to lunch. I go back and open up and reconfigure all 18 hatches. And the point in telling this story to industry groups especially is that at NASA, we've had two fatal accidents. Actually, three, including the Apollo program, but two in-flight accidents. And those accidents were not failures of hardware, really. They were really failures of management and leadership, and failures to look at the things that are very, very unlikely to happen, but have very, very significant consequences. And that is definitely a lesson that we learned with the lives of our colleagues, and I think a lesson that applies in all kinds of industries. Not only do you have to protect for the stuff that is obvious, but you also have to protect for the stuff that is not very obviously, not very likely, but has very significant consequences.
You also have to manage the risk involved. You know, the business you're in, you know, safety and risk management is something that you have to think of really all the time. And we do that aboard the space shuttle or space station. And one of the things is the commander of the space shuttle or the commander of the space station that we try to do at all times is pay attention to the details. It almost always seems like some minor detail is missed that then leads to a chain of events and a catastrophic thing happens at the end. So paying attention to those fine points, those minor details, is so important in taking an operation that is inherently risky, like what we do or like what all of you do, and try to make it as safe as possible.
So eventually it's time for me to come home, and we get back in our Soyuz and we undock. And it's similar to coming back in the space shuttle, is because you burn an engine, you slow down for just a few hundred miles an hour, and the rest of the energy is taken out by the atmosphere. That's where the similarity stops. The space shuttle is kind of like, even though it's risky, it's kind of like driving a Bentley down Park Avenue. Soyuz is much more medieval in how it re-enters the atmosphere, much steeper. You start hitting the atmosphere, and the three sections are exploded apart, and some of this hardware is actually hitting the window. Then as you hit the atmosphere, you're in this fireball, and the window is right by the side of your head, and it's kind of like you look outside and it's like looking into the sun. It gets hot inside. It's kind of like going over Niagara Falls in a barrel, but while you're on fire. And as soon as you realize you're not going to die, it's the most fun you've ever had in your life. Eventually, we parachute opens, you're thrown around wildly, we crash down into the earth, they open the hatch, and I breathe fresh air for the first time in a year. It felt like the first time in my life. Within 24 hours, I'm back in Houston, see my family, go into my house, walk in the front door, out the back door, jump in the swimming pool, come back inside and had some apple pie and beer that was sent from the White House. Took a shower for the first time in a year. Slept in a bed. Best part about all this, best part about coming home, was I had just done the hardest thing I'd ever do in my life. That's what made it so great, doing the hard things. I didn't feel great at first. I know when I came out of the capsule, I had a smile on my face, and if some of you saw that, it was really kind of acting. I was just trying to look better than the two guys I was with. I actually thought I was going to get an Oscar this year, but I understand they sometimes make mistakes, the Oscars. I didn't feel great. You know, I could barely get out of bed. I was so stiff. My muscles and joints were stiff. I would stand up and my legs would swell up, feel all the blood rushing down to my legs. I had hives and rashes everywhere my skin had touched anything, because it hadn't touched anything in an entire year. Flu-like symptoms. Had I not been in space for a year, I probably would have gone to see the doctor to see what was wrong. So when I'm backing away from the space station for the very last time, the space station I spent 520 days of my life on, and I'm looking outside and looking out the window at the truss, and I'm thinking about this, how we built this million-pound space station in low Earth orbit while flying around the Earth at 17,500 miles an hour in a vacuum, in extremes of temperatures of plus or minus 270 degrees, international partnership of 15 countries, different languages, different engineering standards. I'm thinking, you know, if we can do this, the hardest thing we have ever done, we can do anything. If we decide we want to go to Mars, we can go to Mars. If we want to cure cancer and put the resources behind it, we can do that too. If we want to fix our problems with our environment, financial problems. If you want to solve challenges in your industry, after being in space for a year, I was absolutely inspired that if we can dream it, we can do it. If we have a goal and a plan, if we're willing to take risk and fail, if we focus on the things we can control and ignore what we can't, if we test the status quo, and if we work as a team. Because teamwork makes a dream work. We can choose to do the hard things, and if we do that, then the sky is definitely not the limit. Thank you very much, ladies.